Hey everybody, welcome to Massimo Motivation. My name is Christopher Massimo, and today we're going to talk about common video game and gaming myths. So stay tuned. Everybody, welcome to Massimo Motivation. Today we're going to talk about common gaming psychology myths. So before I get started, I do want to preface this by saying that gaming can also be bad. Today we're going to be defending gaming, but there are certain contexts where gaming can become an issue, and you can refer to some of my other videos on that. But today we're going to talk about the myths associated with gaming. So the very first one is the one that you're probably most familiar with, and that's that video games make you violent. That is not true. So we're going to go ahead and debunk that right off the bat. So I want you to think about anger or frustration or rage on a spectrum. And on one side you have rage, true violence, and on one side you have frustration. So in the literature, what you're going to find is that there can be a slight increase from here to here, from here to here, in the amount of anger that someone outwardly portrays if they play a bunch of violent video games like Call of Duty. But what you're not going to find is somebody going from one side of the spectrum to the other and then all of a sudden start becoming violent. You're not going to see that. It doesn't exist. Well, what I should say, honestly, is that it may exist in very rare circumstances, but it's not replicable in the literature, which is really, really important. It's not something that you can anticipate to be a problem. So right off the bat, gaming does not make you a violent person. It can bring out, especially if you're playing multiplayer, some angry tendencies, yelling at your, yelling into your mic, screaming at your teammates for sucking hard, whatever. Like there's an opportunity for you to get angry and outwardly be behaviorally demonstrative in that way, but that doesn't make you at baseline and everything else that you do inherently more angry. So right off the bat, anger makes you, or video games make you angry, gone. The next one is that, watching women who are objectified makes you, as a female gamer, somebody who's more likely to be promiscuous. Not true. A lot of research is actually demonstrating that if you see somebody like a Lara Croft, a Tomb Raider character, if you see somebody like her, your brain is able to differentiate between the fictional world and the real world. So when you see Lara Croft objectified on the screen, it's much different than if you were to see a celebrity on Netflix. Dressing a certain way. Your brain is able, in most instances, to separate what is fiction from reality. Okay, so that one right off the bat, that playing video games as a woman makes you more promiscuous, gone. Okay, that one's out of there. Gamers have a social problem is the next one. This is somewhat true. I think it depends on how you contextualize it. Gamers, a lot of people who turn to gaming for the social piece of it are people who are fully capable of having a good social life outside of gaming. But because of the ease that comes with playing video games, they're more likely to lean into that construct or that avenue into facilitating those relationships than the more traditional route, which can be much more time consuming, a lot more rejection, a lot more face-to-face pain. It's just harder. And so it's not that gamers can't be social, that they all have social problems. It's that it's easier. And if you really think about humans in general, they tend to take the easy way out. So it's hard for me to blame a lot of gamers for going that route. But it comes down to a balancing act, right? But it's not true that all gamers, or even the mass majority of them, are just, they have social anxiety or they have some type of like impairment in their ability to connect with other people. That's silly and not true. The next one is, gamers socially isolate. So this is the stereotypical 15-year-old boy who goes into his room, stays away from his family, and just sits there for hours on end. Now those things do exist. They most definitely do exist because I have clients just like that. But when they're isolating in their rooms, they're often not isolating at all. Most, I would say, that are especially in that age group, in the adolescent age group, most of them are playing multiplayer games. So they're actually playing online with friends through Discord, through Xbox, through PlayStation, through their PC, through Steam, through some type of platform. usually they are accessing a group that they actually feel connected to, who think like them, play the games that they enjoy, have shared interests, instead of their family, who they often feel like they can't connect with or don't get it. So are they really isolating? In a sense, they're isolating from the family system, but to me, that says there's a problem behind the problem. If your child is socially isolating, using video games as the medium to do that, chances are there's a much bigger problem at play than the video game itself. They're simply using that as a medium, likely to connect with people like them. Now, there are the RPG players, which are role-playing games. There are RPG players like myself who prefer single-player experiences. But in my experience, the mass majority of adolescents aren't doing heavy single-player playthroughs. It's multiplayer. It's some type of online unit. So the last one I'll bring up is, playing video games makes you dumb, or you just use it for entertainment. Like, there's no real value for it. And both of those are also wrong. So some studies have actually found that gamers show improvements in several types of attention, sustained attention, memory, working memory, the efficiency of people who play video games with some of their hand-eye coordination type of skills. There's a lot of evidence to show that certain parts of the brain actually light up more, create more connectivity, and actually increase the productivity and effectiveness of those lobes, of those parts of the brain, and those functions. Now, in contrast, something like Netflix does almost nothing. So I actually advocate heavily to play video games over binge watching Netflix, because there are a lot of tangible benefits, also depending on the game, that you can get from a video game that you can't get from a TV show. So video games do not make you stupid. They may prevent you from spending as much time on your education, so they might prevent you from getting educated, but they inherently in and of themselves don't make you dumb, and they're definitely not just used for entertainment purposes. They're used to get scholarships. They're used to build careers. They're used to gain money through esports competitions. They're used to build things like Roblox or Minecraft. There's a lot of instances in which video games are used for things that are much, much wider and more beneficial than staring at a screen and shooting everything that comes into your face that's a zombie, and then just, like, I don't know, repeating that process over and over again with your friends. There's much more to it, especially depending on the game. So I'd argue strongly that video games have their place. You can check out my other video on gaming addiction. Is it legit? I think that it is, but I have some problems with it. Feel free to give that video a look over. But for the most part, video games aren't inherently bad. I feel the same about casinos and gambling. I feel the same about a lot of things. They're not inherently bad. A problem is only a problem if it causes one. So guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope that you can latch onto some of those myths and help me debunk them in the general community and general public. If you enjoyed this video, as always, hit that subscribe button, like, and comment. And remember, mind muscle maximize.